morning. Today is Thursday, January the 6th, and I'm glad to be here this morning. I had a really good night's rest. I hope you did as well. I was so encouraged last night during and after our corporate prayer. I honestly didn't anticipate that we would have much of a turnout last night for corporate prayer. It's woe is me, very lacking in faith I am. But the new year, first week of the year, and the COVID numbers the way they are right now, I kind of anticipated just maybe a handful of folks, but we had a full room last night. And man, just the not just the fact of the numbers, but the depth of prayer last night was just so encouraging. So many of you that I know are sick or dealing with things were lifted up last night and prayed for. Not only that, just seeking the Lord. It was a good night of prayer. And so I'm just thankful that we had that last night. It encouraged me. I don't know about you, but when I come together with the body in corporate prayer where people are calling on the Lord and in sincere hearts are worshiping Him, it encourages me. It lifts me up. And so I just want you to know that we prayed for and we love you, Vanessa. Just praying for you after your treatment on Tuesday, Barbara. Lifting you up with your upcoming cancer surgery that is coming, I think, on the 19th. Joan, we're praying for Ken. Just praying for you as you support him. So many of you just praying for you. Love you. And anyway, this morning I'm going to do things a little bit backwards. I want to close with a song today. And I really had a real turn and twist in my quiet time this morning as I was reading, picking up in the 12th verse, I think, of John chapter 13, as Jesus is there with his disciples on that evening before he would be betrayed, or that evening he would be betrayed before he would go to the cross. And he's there at the Passover, and we pick up in verse 12, such a familiar passage. And it's easy sometimes when we go in our quiet time to a passage that we know, to look beyond what maybe the Lord is wanting us to see that day and just revert back to what we already know about the passage. But this morning, something really struck me. And let me just read the first few verses and then I'll share with you what struck me. Beginning in verse 12 of chapter 13, when he, that is Jesus, had washed their feet, and we know that there is referring to all of their disciples. Now, let that register in your mind. All of his disciples were there as he washed their feet. And then he asked them the question, do you understand what I have done to you? And he's going to give an explanation as to what that understanding is. Verse 13, he says, you call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. And so the answer to the question, do you realize what I've done for you, what he's demonstrating to them as he is their teacher, their rabbi, and their master, he has humbled himself to wash their feet. And he goes on to say in verse 15 that he has given them an example, that you also should do this as I have done to you. And here the example is, no matter what position or role that we may hold or fulfill within life, or particularly the body of Christ, we should always be willing to humble ourselves and serve others. We don't ever get to a place that we are expected to be served rather than serving others. I think of my role in my home as a husband and the head of my household. I shouldn't have the idea that my wife is just there to serve me because I'm in a role of leadership in the home. No, we're called to, as husbands, we're called to serve our wives. And so he says, I've given you an example. Then verse 16, he says, truly, truly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now here, Jesus is referring to him being the messenger that the Father has sent. And so Jesus didn't have the attitude that he could be greater than the Father. We know that they're co-equal, although the Father has, I guess, the way to describe that would be a more authoritative role in that, in the triune. We see Jesus submitted to the will of the Father, and the Holy Spirit serves the Son. So verse 17, he says, if you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. So there's a blessing in us following and being obedient to that that command to serve. He says, I am not speaking of all of you, for I know whom I have chosen, but the scripture will be fulfilled. He who ate my bread has lifted his heel against me. I am telling you this now before it takes place, that when it does take place, you may believe that I am he. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever receives the one I sent receives me, and whoever receives me receives the one who sent me. Now here, Jesus is beginning to talk about the fact that one of the 12 was going to betray him. And he goes on in verse 21 and on to explain to them, there will be one of them among them that will betray him. And of course, the question is asked to him, Jesus, which one of us is going to betray you? And Jesus says, the one that I take this morsel of bread and dip it in the wine and give to them and they eat it, that's the one that's going to betray me. Now, here's what struck me this morning. Who was present when Jesus humbled himself and washed their feet? Well, the answer to that is all of the apostles were present. And we know that Matthew was present, Thomas was present, James, John, all of the rest. But significantly, Judas Iscariot was present when Jesus washed their feet. Now, here's the thing that really struck me. That Jesus, knowing that Judas was going to betray him, one that Jesus had loved for 3 years as he walked with him, one that Jesus had instructed, one that Jesus was as close to and loved just like he did the other apostles, this one betrayed him. And it just struck me that Jesus demonstrated love and grace and humility even to the one that he knew was going to betray him. And I realized that he has given that command that I have given you an example. Now you go and do likewise. And so when I thought about applying this truth and this principle in my own life, I had to confess, Lord, I don't know that I could humble myself and love and wash the feet of one that I knew was going to betray me. It's hard enough for me to love someone and truly love someone who has hurt me or who has offended me or who has come against me. But here Jesus gives us a command that is so very difficult to follow in. And I would say it is impossible to follow in if we are not submitted and yielded to him, and only the Holy Spirit can cause us to love one, to humble ourselves before one who has betrayed us or who has hurt us. Several of the verses that I want to read to you that without giving much explanation, but we find in Matthew's gospel in chapter 5, in the Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus said this about loving our enemies. Now, was Judas Iscariot Jesus' enemy? You bet he was. He was going to betray Jesus. And it wasn't that Jesus made him his enemy, but Judas made Jesus his enemy. Verse 43, Jesus says this of Matthew chapter 5. He says, you have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and he sends rain on the just and the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? And if you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? You therefore must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. So here Jesus' command is that we are to love our enemies. Now that is a difficult thing. Can you think of an enemy that you have right now? Someone who's offended you, someone you're estranged from, someone who has just violated you. Jesus tells us that we're to love that person. Now, it's a lot easier said than done. And I would say, based on my experience, I cannot do that on my own. It has to be the Holy Spirit that enables me to love my enemy. Verse 9 of chapter 3 in 1 Peter, Peter writes this. He says, "Do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, bless. For to do this you were called, that you may obtain a blessing." And so here Peter's given us the instruction that when one does evil to us, we are not supposed to return with evil, but we're to love that individual. One last verse or passage that I'm going to share to you with you this morning is in Romans chapter 12. Well, Paul writes this, really repeating what Jesus has commanded. He says in verse 14, "Bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse." Again, we see a kingdom principle here and coming in the opposite spirit. You see, the kingdom of God is extremely contrary to the kingdom of the world. And here, the world would say that if somebody persecutes you, then you respond by persecuting them. But here Paul says, no, you're to bless that person. Then he goes on in verse 17 in the same passage to say again, "Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. If possible, as far as depends on you, live peaceably with all." Now, let me pause there and make just a comment. It's not possible to live at peace with everybody, because there are those that just refuse to live peacefully. But here he says, as much as depends on you, be at peace with all men. And so what that tells me is that I have no excuse to be unpeaceable to someone who is not exhibiting peace to me. But I am called as a follower of Christ, as much depends on me, to be at peace with all men. And so he goes on to say, verse 19, "Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God. For it is written, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay,' says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, then feed him. If he is thirsty, then give him something to drink. For by doing so, you will heap burning coals on his head." Here Paul tells us to come in the opposite spirit. Boy, what a message we need to hear today in our culture, in our world. We are so divided in this nation, in the country. We're so divided in the body of Christ. But if we're going to be followers of Christ, if we're going to truly be disciples of Christ, he tells us that we've got to come in an opposite spirit, and we've got to display the grace of God even to those who are our enemies. Boy, that's a piercing message. I'll be honest with you. For me, it's not easy. We've got to depend on the Holy Spirit. If we're going to be different, if we're going to be marked different, if we're going to make an impact for the kingdom of God, may God help us to be different in a world that's so divided. Marvelous grace of our loving God, grace that exceeds sin and our guilt, yonder on Calvary's mount, outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon. Sinful. be conscious to display God's grace. Remember these words that, boy, when our enemy comes against us, we're to respond in likeness and kindness of Jesus if we're truly Christ followers. And I believe that God will use that. If we come in an opposite spirit, that God will use that for us to be able to plant a seed of the gospel in somebody's heart. God will use that we're able to cultivate a seed of the gospel that's already been planted. And God will use that by His grace and His mercy to see a harvest as we reap where we've not sown, where we reap where we've not cultivated. And pray and ask God to use you today. Well, I pray the Lord blesses you and keeps you. I look forward to seeing you this weekend. Just a reminder, we have Ben Clark and his sisters, the Purple Hulls, will be sharing with us in music and song and the Word on Sunday morning at 10 a.m. Bring somebody with you. It's a great opportunity to bring an unchurched or unsaved friend. And then men, 5:30 this Sunday, we have our men's smokeout barbecue. Dennis Parker is going to be there to share with us in song and testimony. You do not have to register to be there. We encourage you to come and bring somebody with you. I pray the Lord blesses you and keeps you, that His face would shine upon you, and you'd have a great day. I love you.